Welcome back to Rasmapsar TV. Today I have Reinier van Noort from Netherlands, Holland here, who is an instructor in historical martial arts from Europe, or HEMA, as some people might call it. Hi, Reinier, how are you?
Hello, Manoj. I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly. I forgot to check that with you. But hello, and thank you for inviting me here to the channel. I'm doing pretty well. How are you?
I'm very fine. Good to have you here. Okay, Reinier, we are going to start. First of all, tell us a bit about yourself, about who you are, your educational background, and then martial arts background, please.
Yeah, well, I'm actually Dr. Reinier van Noort. If we talk about educational background, I'm an experimental geologist who got his degree in Utrecht University in the Netherlands. And I work on experimental research into fluid rock, fluid mineral interactions, from physical interactions like the transport of fluids through rocks, which is what I'm working on now, to chemical interactions like dissolution and precipitation of minerals, that sort of thing. I am Dutch, but I live in Norway nowadays. So we're talking from my basement in Norway.
Okay. And
that's sort of my professional background. In martial arts, I did a little bit of judo as a kid, like 1 or 2 years, a little bit of taekwondo as well. And then I didn't actually do anything until 2013, when I was about 23, and a friend asked me if I wanted to join her for a fencing class. So I started doing some foil fencing at university when I was already working on my PhD. It was in 2003. And then in 2005, I got an invitation over the summer to a sword fighting course, and that's how I rolled into HEMA.
Very nice. Let me just go back to your education, because I'm very interested in minerals. Could you tell us about, do you work at the university or for a company in this field?
I work for a research institute, so it's a little bit in between.
Okay. And what type of minerals are you specialized in?
I mean silicates, but that's most geologists. Silicates. In addition to carbonates.
Okay, very nice.
I've done my PhD research on the compaction of sandstone, so that's quartz. But yeah. I've also done a lot of research into dissolution of olivine and the precipitation of magnesium carbonates when olivine reacts with CO2 and water. And I've done some other dissolution studies on a range of mixtures of minerals, of natural rocks, actually. So it's I don't specialize in a specific mineral. It's more that I specialize in the processes, the interactions between fluids and rocks, and in how to experimentally investigate those.
Back to martial arts, you said that you did judo, and did you like judo?
I think back then, I mean, this is when I was about 6, 7, 8, around that age. I didn't particularly enjoy it, per se, I think.
Okay.
I wasn't very good at it either.
Okay. And then, you did then judo, and then later on fencing and historical martial arts. Okay. Could you tell us a bit about your experience in historical martial arts from Europe? Which style do you practice?
Mm-hmm.
Is it a German school? Is it an Italian school? Or what do you concentrate on?
My main focus is still 17th century rapier fencing, and it has been that since 2010, approximately. And there I focused first on a treatise written in Dutch. You know, being a Dutchman, I was drawn to that source, written by a German by the name of Bruchius, but he wrote it in Dutch and he published it in Leiden. And this treatise describes a style of fencing that's very common in Germany in the 17th century, but which originally comes from the style of fencing introduced by Italian fencing master Salvatore Fabrice, who was a fencing master for the King of Denmark around the 1600s, and before that for a high German noble in northern Germany somewhere. So he introduced a style of fencing which became very popular in Germany very quickly. In say a decade or two, it completely took over fencing in Germany, and it sort of pushed out the old Lichtenauer and De Ryth styles that were practiced before. So yeah, I started with the book by Bruchius. I've been looking a lot at the other German treatises published between 1620 and now past 1700. Currently, I'm focusing more on a manuscript known by the code C13, which is it's held by the library in Dresden. The interesting thing is this manuscript has a dedication signed off by Johann Georg Pascha, who was a much published fencing master in the second half of the 1600s. But he, in his dedication, he says, "Oh, I got this book that describes the fencing style of Salvatore. I got this from a friend, and this is really good stuff. So I kind of like it. I'm going to use it. But you know, it's not perfect. It's missing some parries, and it doesn't say much about grappling. So I added that, and now it's much better than it was even." So he kind of took the he completely plagiarized another manuscript. And then he took the arrogance of also saying that he made it better by adding some stuff. But it's a very thorough manuscript, which provides a lot of insights into Fabrice's style. It fills up his Fabrice's own book is already very clear, but this fills in a lot of details and fleshes it out and gives more insights, which I appreciate. The other interesting thing is that we also know about a manuscript in the UK, in London, I don't remember exactly where it's held, which is the same manuscript as the one that Pascha copied, minus the edits that Pascha made. So we can actually see where he changed the manuscript, where he put in his own bits to make it better.
So it's interesting. So it's the first time I'm talking to someone who is using a Dutch manuscript. Okay, could you just tell us about this Dutch manuscript more? I mean, how many pages it has? Does it have illustrations? Could you just tell us? And what weapons besides rapier does it deal with, or is it only rapier?
It's not a manuscript. It's a printed book. The Dutch one, the van Bruchius. Mm-hmm. It has, if I remember correctly, 36. Plates, and each plate shows two pairs of fences. So in total, we have 144 fences. Mm-hmm. I don't remember the page count exactly. You have to forgive me for that. It gives a short introduction on just the principles of fencing, on important principles like measure, tempo, that sort of thing. And then it has 212 individual lessons where these where these principles are applied, and these lessons are categorized in chapters with these lessons work on the thrusting quarter, so that's the thrust on the inside line. These lessons work on the thrust on the outside line. These lessons show how to use a specific technique, etc.
Okay. And how do they call the sword in this manuscript or in this, I don't know how to call it, this treatise or treatise, how do they call the sword?
I believe they just call it a sword or a degen, but actually Bruchius may use the word rapier. Here we have the English translation that I published with Keith Farrell and Follenbrook a couple of years ago. So this is one of the plates. So this shows the lunge right here. Mm-hmm. This is the posture in quarta, one of the main postures. And here at the bottom, we see an engagement on the inside line. Yeah. Let me just check what word he used for the sword. So he used degen, which is the same as the German word degen. And he used rapier, rapier.
Used rapier? Wow. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not that common, but in the German works they I think in German it means practice sword, doesn't it?
Yeah,
that time. Yeah, so there we see it a bit more.
Very interesting. Okay very interesting. So you wrote this book, you translated it from Dutch into English, did I understand you correctly?
Yeah, that's actually how I got involved into rapier fencing, because I was end of 2009, I was stuck at home with a horrible stomach flu, but my mind was fully operational, and I was looking at this this book, and I'd looked at it before, and oh, it looks horrible. These images look bad, and it doesn't look, and it's rapier. I wasn't interested at all. And I was stuck at home with nothing to do. So I was like, oh, let's try and translate this, and maybe somebody else can do something with it. And as I was working on this translation, I, you know, more and more like, hey, this is interesting. Oh, hey, that's actually pretty cool. And these images that looked so bad a couple of months before, they started looking very interesting as well, much, much better. So that's how I got interested.
Why did they look bad to you? I don't understand.
I don't know. The first time I looked at this treatise, it was a very bad quality scans. And, okay. You know, if you're looking for color images and that kind of thing, then you're in bad luck with old fashioned printing techniques. And you didn't really see the details. But later, when I was cleaning these scans and you know, making them black and white instead of colors of gray, you start seeing the detail, you start appreciating them much more. Also, I visited a few copies in libraries, and I must say, even a high quality modern print doesn't really look the same as the original print made with a plate, if you can get to see the originals in a library somewhere.
Okay, so you did that. I believe I saw you. I don't remember. I think I saw you definitely once. I remember I saw you in the United States once. Was it in an event? Are you more active in the American scene or in European scene as far as HEMA is concerned?
Well, we first met in Germany in the International Saber Symposium a couple of years.
That's true. Yeah, of course. I forgot that completely. I'm too much concentrated on American events. I just remember, don't even remember the European events. Okay, yeah, that's right. That's right. It was in Germany, correct? Okay. Yes.
And then the second time we met was at the Western Martial Arts Workshop in Chicago a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Back when I lived in the Netherlands, it's really easy to just visit anywhere in Europe. You know, you get in your car, you start driving, and you'll be there a couple of hours later. One of the things I learned when I moved to Norway in 2014 is that these 1,000 kilometers are a big difference if you want to drive anywhere. Because if I want to drive anywhere, it just adds 800 to 1,000 kilometers to how long I need to drive. Yes. Compared to where I was in the Netherlands, unless it's in northern Norway, if I'm northern Europe. So I'm kind of, and also I bought an electric car, so I can't even do more than 140 kilometers before I have to pause. So now I'm stuck flying to events and having kids. I can't go to as many events as I used to, which means I limit my travels, and that means I do travel a bit more to events that are far away, where I get the opportunity to see a new place. So I have been to, there's a long way of saying I've been to a few more events further from home than I used to in the last few years, well before Corona hit anyway.
Of course. Are you also involved in teaching fencing and swordsmanship or practicing at the moment, or in general?
Mostly teaching. So mm-hmm. after I made that translation, or while I was making the translation, the same friend who took me to a modern Olympic fencing class, she came to me and she said, "Hey, Reinier, I hear you are getting involved in this sword fighting thing. I'm really interested in the rapier. Do you happen to know if there's anybody who can teach me how to fence with a rapier in the Netherlands?" And at the time, the only groups in the Netherlands that we had were doing longsword. So I said, "No, there's nobody who's doing that in the Netherlands, but maybe I have a plan." So we found a location, and we made a plan, and we just rented a hall for 2 hours, and I took the book, and we took our fencing foils, because that was all we had, and we just played with what was in the book a bit, of course, carefully, and we had a good time. So then we agreed to do this weekly, and after a couple of months, we built up a bit of knowledge to start from, and we started saying, "Hey, we're teaching fencing now." So we had some people come in, and I was lucky, got, you know, like one or two experienced fencers from Olympic fencing coming in, which can greatly help in understanding what's going on, and we just restarted as a study group studying this work, trying to understand what Bruchius wrote, and gradually that grew into more of a school where I did the teaching. Of course, at some point I just moved to Norway. It keeps coming back to that. And here I found a local group and I asked them, do you need a rapier fencer? And they said, well, yeah, we can use a rapier fencer. So actually the group that I've been longest with, the longest now, is the Frie Duelister in Oslo. So right now we can't do much fencing because of the corona situation. We've just got permission to do outdoor events in small groups, but the weather has been pretty bad. It looks like maybe after the summer break, because the summer break also started this week, we'll be able to go back to our fencing hall, which is a normal sports hall in the school. So then hopefully we can go back to a bit more normal practice again after 2 years of hardly any.
Okay, so did I understand you correctly? You only teach rapier, no longsword?
No longsword. I did do a second group for a while here in Norway where we did the, what HEMA people call side sword. So that's the Italian cut and thrust sword of the 1500s, so about 100 years before rapier.
Yeah.
And that was really interesting and fun to work with as well. But I moved around, I got too far from the hall to make it there, and then the corona situation started when I was already thinking like, I can't make this anymore. So I had to drop that. So maybe my son is 2.5 now, maybe in a couple of years he'll be a bit easier again, and I'll have time again to do 2 trainings a week.
Why didn't you concentrate on longsword where many people do longsword? Especially in Middle Europe and Northern Europe, many people are longsword fighters.
Longsword was where I got started. So the group I got started with, that was a medievalish group focusing largely on longsword, but also doing a lot of stunt fighting that I was less interested in. It just happened. So yeah, I was very longsword focused. And at some point I started working with rapier. One of the advantages with the later work is that people had a better understanding how to write an instructional work. So for a lot of the longsword, people work with these manuscripts on the Lichtenauer tradition, and they have to heavily interpret teachings that may have been written in a hard to understand way on purpose. Whereas with the rapier books, you start having works that were written with the intention of, at least the intention of being understood. They're not always achieve that intention for sure, but at least the authors had the intention of writing a book that somebody could understand, that just somebody could understand, not one of their own students, but also somebody who's not one of their students. So maybe I was lazy, maybe I wanted to do something a little easier to understand, but I don't think that's entirely it. And then as I started playing around with rapier, and as I started understanding things and also understanding longsword, because for a short time I did both, better because of rapier, I just fell in love more with rapier than I was with a longsword.
Okay. Do you do also rapier and dagger, or a companion weapon with it?
Interestingly, Bruchius, he wrote his book on the single rapier. And he, in his introduction, he wrote a number of things that he would also write a book about. And one of them was rapier and dagger. But he never wrote any of the other works. And originally, my plan to myself was, you know what, I'll do single rapier for a couple of years, build up an understanding, and then I'll do rapier and dagger, because I thought that would be much, much cooler. As I was working with single rapier, and as I've been doing that for more than 10 years now, I'm still at the stage where I'm like, you know, I could understand this better before I pick up a dagger. Also, I've come to a place where I don't really feel that a dagger is so necessary. I still haven't really gotten around to doing rapier and dagger. When I did the cut and thrust sword in the other group there, we did pick up the dagger after a year or two and started mixing both single sword and sword and dagger. And that was also really good fun. But with the rapier, I kind of like the more intellectual game that you get with a single rapier.